हेलो फ्रेंड्स, आई एम डॉक्टर गीतिका दत्ता, प्रिंसिपल भवन लीलावती मुंशी कॉलेज ऑफ एजुकेशन, भारतीय विद्या भवन, कस्तूरबा गांधी मार्ग, न्यू दिल्ली. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक, दैट इज प्लानिंग फॉर टीचिंग एंड लर्निंग. सिंस ऑल ऑफ अस आर इन द प्रोफेशन ऑफ एजुकेशन, लेट अस ट्राई टू सी अ सिनेरियो. मिस्टर राकेश, हु इज अ मेरिट होल्डर, इज अपॉइंटेड एज अ TGT फॉर सोशल साइंसेज एंड ही इज गिवन क्लास 7th टू टीच. And he is to take up the geography portion. Let us see his what are his thoughts. So he is thinking like that, since he is a university merit holder, so he knows the content very well. So he is thinking like, wow, I'll be meeting my class tomorrow and the topics are my favorite. I know them so well. I don't even have to prepare for this class. That's great. I can take these topics just like that. It's going to be a cakewalk and I'm going to be very popular with my students. But somehow things don't turn out the way he has anticipated. Why? Because there are number of reasons. Merely knowing the content is not enough. A person needs to prepare very well in advance, because knowing something for your own sake is a different matter altogether, but having or transacting that in the class is very different. So for that we need to know the how to plan our instruction. So let us try to break up the instructional planning word into instruction and planning. So let us see what is instruction. Now generally in general English language, instructions merely mean giving directions to somebody, but here in the field of education, instruction has a specific meaning. It means planned arrangement of experiences to help a learner develop understanding and to achieve a desirable change in behavior. This definition is given by Kellogg and Kellogg in 1999. Simply or in simple words, we can say that it basically refers to the teaching learning process. So when we as teachers, we are not just concerned with teaching. If our teaching is not resulting into learning, that means no teaching has taken place. So instruction is a bipolar process. It includes teaching as well as learning, and it's considered to be a very systematic process. Now let us look into the concept of instructional planning. Planning, as we all know, we plan for number of things. Planning is deciding in advance what is to be done and the way in which it has to be done. So instructional planning has been defined as the ability of the teacher to visualize and forecast into the future of what, why and how of the teaching learning process. So as we can see, it's a tripolar process, instructional planning. We need to do the need analysis. Needs analysis means we need to see or understand, we as teachers, we need to understand what exactly needs to be done or what are the needs of our learners. Second most important thing is formulating objectives and evaluation procedures and selecting methods and procedures. So all of these three different polars give us the answers to why. Needs analysis will give us the answer of why do we need to do this. Formulating objectives and evaluation is about what, and selecting methods and procedures is about how. Okay students, now we will discuss why do we need to have instructional planning, why is it important. The first and the foremost point is it provides direction to the teacher, to the students and all stakeholders ki exactly what is to be done and the way in which it has to be done. If the teacher and the students, they are clear about what is to be done, things become much easier. Secondly, it develops insight about the broader educational goals. So teachers also, they are working towards a goal, and your small chapters or topics, they are just you can say they are signposts to attain that goal. So they will know exactly the way in which we are proceeding to the ultimate goals and aims, and it economizes on the effort, cost and time of teachers as well as students. As I mean, like we can discuss this thing, when a teacher goes into a class for a class of say 30 minutes, and on an average we have minimum of 30 students, 40 students, 50 students, at times 60 students also sitting in that one class. So you can look into the kind of man hours which are involved. 30 minutes of the teacher plus 30 into 30 students, 30 minutes into 30 students, 30 minutes into 40 students. So that is the amount of time which is going into the entire instructional transaction. So if we are wasting that time, it is not good, and it is a huge responsibility on the teacher's part that the time spent on any kind of instruction should be it should be well, it should be fruitful. So that is why instructional planning is extremely important, and the probability of making mistakes decreases because teachers would know that what is to be done, and yes, through feedback, yes, they can also improvise upon their mistakes if they happen, and it's a very good source of feedback to the teachers on their own and their students' performance or achievement. So if we know in the first instance what are we trying to do and have we been able to achieve that, so we can see the gaps. Now we'll try to see what are the components of a complete instructional plan. The first and the foremost is statement of philosophy. So philosophy is very important. Philosophy of a nation, philosophy of a society, philosophy of a school or say an institution. So what exactly are we aiming for? Then comes the needs analysis. In statement of philosophy, we can say that educational systems vary according to countries. Say educational system of our country is following a philosophy of our country. Educational system of some other countries, they follow philosophy of their country. So understanding the basic philosophy is very important. Then comes needs analysis, ki what exactly are the needs of our learners and our society. We need to bring a parity between the needs of our society and the needs of our learners so that our learners become fruitful members of our society. So we need to work towards that. The third point is aims, goals and objectives. So as we already know that aims, goals and objectives, they form a kind of a hierarchy. Aims are the broader and most comprehensive targets which are to be achieved. Goals are means to achieve the aims, and objectives are means to attain the goals. So we have to be very particular about or very clear about the aims, goals and objectives. Then we talk of vertical articulation. Vertical articulation is the subject matter that we are going to deal with now. How is it related to the student's previous knowledge and their future learning? So there has to be a vertical relationship in the way we are proceeding with the content. Then we come to horizontal articulation, which means we are not teaching any unit or subject in isolation. It has to have interrelationships with other subjects. So that means we need to see how each subject matter is interconnected to other subject matters. And then we have the next point, that is sequentially planned learning activities. Now, once we are clear with our content and how is it related with other content areas, then we think about what teaching learning activities should be there. Then we come to the next point, that is the resources needed. What material and medias are required? You need books or textbooks or reference books or the internet or ICT resources or some other kinds of teaching aids. So it's basically about deciding what resources are required. And last may we it comes the assessment strategies. So what assessment strategies are we going to use? Now the days of simple paper and pencil test are gone. So these days we emphasize on a comprehensive list of various tools and techniques of evaluation. So we need to decide on those as well. Next comes the steps of instructional planning. So once we are through with all of these, then we need to see what are the now in the way in which we are going to proceed. First step is select a suitable theme, topic or problem. So what topic, what unit, what chapter are we talking about? We should be very clear with that. Another thing that I would want to make very clear is instructional planning happens at every level. Instructional planning can happen at the overall subject level also. It can happen at the chapter level also. It can happen at a unit level also. It can happen for the entire semester. It can happen for the entire academic session also. So we need to see at what level are we doing this instructional planning. So we are selecting the suitable topic or chapter or subject area. We decide on the goals of the unit, then we select suitable learning objectives. We frame suitable learning objectives preferably in behavioral terms, which tell us what exactly the students will be able to do after the instructional process is over. Next comes the details of the instructional procedures. That means what instructional methods are we going to use? What approaches are we going to use? You must have studied various instructional methods like the lecture method or discussion method or group methods like problem solving, projects or case studies. So we need to decide what instructional procedures are to be followed. प्लान फॉर प्री असेसमेंट एंड असेसमेंट ऑफ स्टूडेंट लर्निंग. दैट मीन्स वी विल नाउ डिसाइड कि इन वॉट वे द स्टूडेंट्स आर गोइंग टू बी असेस्ड. सो सिंस वी आर इवॉल्विंग विद आर इंस्ट्रक्शनल प्रोसीजर्स और मेथड्स, वी आर ऑल्सो इवॉल्विंग विद आर असेसमेंट स्ट्रैटेजीज. सो वी आर नॉट जस्ट कंटेंट विद एज आई ऑलरेडी सेड कि सिंपल पेपर एंड पेंसिल टेस्ट. वी हैव टू थिंक ऑफ अदर वेज ऑफ असेसिंग आर स्टूडेंट्स, स्पेशली वेन दे आर इन्वॉल्व इन ग्रुप एक्टिविटीज. एंड देन वी नीड टू थिंक अबाउट और प्लान फॉर suitable instructional materials or media. So these are the entire steps of instructional planning. Now let us decide what are the, this is the second very important topic of our discussion, that is considerations for instructional planning. So when we are doing our instructional planning, what exactly points are we supposed to consider? So number of points are there. Number one is national curriculum standards and philosophy, subject area requirements, then school environment, learners and their diverse needs, materials and resources. Then we come to time frames available and planned varied experiences. Now we'll be discussing all of these points in brief in the coming slides. So first of all, we come to national curriculum standards and philosophy. Now we are a democratic nation, and for framing of educational policies we have the NCERT and NEWPA. So these national apex bodies, they come out with national curriculum frameworks and national education policy from time to time. So we need to look into what are the current policies which are being given in these national documents. So we have national curriculum framework. The latest national curriculum framework came in 2005. So we have national curriculum framework 2005. Indian government is at present working on the latest national policy on education. There was a draft national policy on education which came in the year 2019. So we need to look into the national documents to understand the overall vision of the government towards education, and then we also need to see the philosophy and epistemology of that particular subject area and discipline. Because if somebody is a science teacher, need to understand the epistemology of sciences. The social science teachers or the language teachers, they need to understand the epistemology of their own subject specific area and how to optimize learning in that particular area. Then we have certain subject specific requirements for each subject, say mathematics or languages or say sciences, social sciences. So we need to see, we need to understand the nature of each subject area for say mathematics, languages, etc., and understanding the rationale of teaching that subject area at that level. So as the levels go on increasing, the complexity of the subject matter also increases. So we need to understand ki at that level, say at class 6 level or at class 7th level, what is the rationale, what do we expect, or what kind of skills are expected on the part of the students to be mastered. Then we have the understanding the overall goals of that particular subject matter, topic or unit, and locating them vertically and horizontally. So then we need to look into these each and every chapter. कि how is it related vertically. That means say for example if you are dealing with natural resources at class 6 level, we also have natural resource, we may have natural resources at class 9th level or class 11th level. The content in each of these levels will be different. So we need to see how these are related vertically. The complexity of the content changes as the students are going from class one class to the higher class, and horizontally how each of these subject areas, say mathematics or history or political science, they can be correlated with other subject areas. None of the subjects are to be taught in isolation, and there has to be context built so that students also need to understand that these subjects are not separate isolated beings. Next very important criteria is the school environment. What kind of a school are you working? So we need to understand the philosophy and organization of the school. Each school generally they work with a philosophy, because most of the schools are controlled by some trust or say some society. So what philosophy, what is the philosophy of that particular school, and we need to understand that, and then the kind of environment which is there in the school, say for example physical environment or the infrastructural environment. Some schools are very elite type of schools. You will have all the very well equipped classrooms, smart boards, whiteboards, green boards, etc. And some schools may have very minimal kind of infrastructure available. So we need to understand, and then we need to devise our instructional planning according to the facilities which are available. The social environment, some schools are very open, they are democratic, whereas others may not be. So we also need to understand what is the social environment, what are the relationships between the management and the administrators and the teachers, and what is the relationship of students with the teachers. So all of these are also very important consideration. And then the technological environment. These days with the advancements in ICT, we understand that there are many schools which are too much into technology and therefore make good use of the ICT resources, whereas many other schools may not be so advanced with their technological environment. So our instructional planning has to coincide with the school environment. Then we also need to see the degrees of freedom. How much freedom is being given to the teacher? How much agency is given to the teacher? Some schools or some environments permit more freedoms or give more freedom to the teachers, whereas some systems may not allow. So we also have to take into consideration these factors. Then very important, and or the most important thing, is the learners. Who are our learners? So we need to see our learners, we need to understand our learners and understanding their needs. So in a normal classroom, we will find different types of learners. We have these so-called normal learners, and then we have children with special needs, children who may have intellectual deficiency or some kind of learning disabilities or some conduct disorders like attention deficit hyperactivity disorder or conduct disorder or autism spectrum disorders or cerebral palsy or some kind of physical or locomotor disability. Or we may have gifted children who are very intelligent or very creative or very talented. We also may have socially disadvantaged groups of children in our classrooms. We may have children who are emotionally disadvantaged because of various reasons or financially disadvantaged. So we need to plan our instruction according to the needs and according to the needs of our learners, keeping in mind all the different kinds of learners that we have in our classes. Next, we come to materials and resources. What materials are required and what materials are available? We need to see what is required and what are available, and or the medias which can be generated, keeping in mind the cost considerations. We cannot be impractical, or we cannot be very lofty about our this thing. Instructional planning has to be practical, it has to be feasible, and it has to be applicable. So we cannot be talking in the air. And cost considerations are very important for any organization. No organization can afford to spend too much of money on any specific instructional aid and ICT resources. What generally it is also seen that ICT resources are available, it reduces, teachers are just sitting in the classroom doing nothing, and there is some video, something going on. ICT is an aid, teaching aid. It should never take over the role of a teacher. So these things are there. Then we have very important practical consideration, how much time is available. Because generally teachers are too hard pressed for time, so they may not be able to do everything that they may want to do. So we need to decide what instructional planning, or we need to decide upon the methods and media depending upon how much time is available, and kind of draw a equilibrium between time and your instructional requirements. Then we should be having variety of learning experiences. Say the new evolved methods of instruction like projects or case studies, or basically instructional methods where students are working on their own, groups are working on their own, they are very important, they are very hugely beneficial to the students, but they take a lot of time. So we need to decide upon variety of learning experiences. We must have variety of learning experiences, keeping in mind the time. Next, we come to planned varied experiences. So as I already said, the focus has to be that the students should be getting maximum or the most variety of optimal learning experiences, so that these learning experiences cater to the needs of each and every learner. Different learners learn differently. So we should be having different kinds of learning experiences which are beneficial or which may prove to be beneficial for different kinds of learners. Generally, we see that instructional methods are divided into three different types, that is the teacher-centered methods of instruction, learner-centered methods of instruction and group-centered methods of instruction. Under teacher-centered methods of instruction, we have lectures, team teaching, games, quizzes, demonstrations, etc. Under learner-centered, that means each individual learners, they are working individually. So we have individual projects, problem solving, case studies, term papers, assignments, presentations, etc. Then we have group-centric methods of instruction where the groups are working on their own. So we have group discussions, group projects, seminars, conferencing, brainstorming, etc., etc. So as they say that don't keep all your eggs in one basket. Therefore, we should not be having single kind of teaching learning experiences for our students. We all should be having a good mix of all different kinds of teaching learning experiences, because all of these teaching learning experiences or methods or approaches, they have merits and demerits of their own. So keeping in mind their merits and demerits, we can opt for a good a portfolio of teaching learning experiences for our students, which our instructional planning, if we do it nicely and properly, can provide us. So with these words, I would like to wish all of you a very happy instructional planning. In this particular session, we have learnt about what is instruction, what is instructional planning, what are the different components of instructional planning, what are the merits of doing instructional planning, the processes of instructional planning, and finally, the various components or considerations that we need to keep in mind while doing our instructional planning. Thank you so much and have a great time.